Good morning and welcome to the Church of St. Barnabas here in downtown St. Lambert. It's so nice to see each and every one of you here today. And for those who are listening in, either on YouTube or even at Les Jardins Intérieurs, next Saturday morning, they'll be seeing and listening to what we're doing here today. So it's great. And today we're moving from understanding to teaching. For indeed, blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe. But you have all come to believe. And so that's wonderful. And a few announcements that on Friday, May the 27th and Saturday, May the 28th, we're going to be having our book sale again. And it's been quite a few years since we've done this. And there's a committee that's organizing and getting the books ready. And even the facility, the place is being ready so that when people come in, they'll see the new St. Barnabas and to be able to mingle and get together. And also, if people want to come on Wednesday afternoons, it's a pilot project, Wednesday, April the 27th, from 1:30 to 3 p.m. You can come and sit in our library. There's talk of tea, but there's no guarantee about tea. But we're inviting people just to come to gather and to take a book and to read it. And the other day, one of our parishioners, who's a little bit nervous still about coming to the congregation because of COVID, was down there all alone, reading a book in the St. Barnabas Library. And it just warmed our hearts. And speaking of warming hearts, Barbara Brown, you told me, so that's it. You know I'm gonna tell it. Tomorrow, Barbara Brown is celebrating 29 years, which translates into, can I say it?
94.
You heard it from 94, congratulations. So let's all continue to stand and celebrate. Hallelujah. Barbara, the strife is over.
Le Seigneur est vivant, ressuscité.
Alleluia.
Que sa grâce et sa paix soient avec vous.
Qu'ils vont nous faire de joie.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Glory to God in the highest,
and peace to his people on earth.
Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Now in preparation to hear God's word, let us pray. Almighty and eternal God, the strength of those who believe and the hope of those who doubt, may we, who have not seen, have faith, and receive the fullness of Christ's blessing, who is alive and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated.
Et le grand prêtre se mit à les interroger. Il leur dit, « Nous vous avions sévèrement défendu d'enseigner au nom de cet homme. Et qu'avez-vous fait? Vous avez répandu votre enseignement dans toute la ville de Jérusalem et vous voulez nous rendre responsables de sa mort? » Pierre et les apôtres répondirent, « Nous devons obéir à Dieu plutôt qu'aux hommes. Le Dieu de nos ancêtres a rendu la vie à ce Jésus que vous aviez fait mourir en le clouant sur la croix. Dieu l'a élevé à sa droite et l'a établi comme chef et sauveur pour donner l'occasion au peuple d'Israël de changer de comportement et de recevoir le pardon de ses péchés. Nous sommes témoins de ces événements, nous et le Saint-Esprit que Dieu a donné à ceux qui lui obéissent. La parole du Seigneur.
The psalm this morning is Psalm 150. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise him for his mighty deeds. Praise him according to his surpassing greatness.
Praise him with the trumpet sound. Praise him with the harp.
Praise him with tambourine and dance. Praise him with strings and pipe.
Praise him with clanging cymbals. Praise him with loud clashing cymbals.
Let everything that breathes praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
A reading from Revelation. John, to the seven churches that are in Asia. Grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. To him who loves us and freed us from our sins by his blood and made us to be a kingdom, priests serving his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Look, he is coming with the clouds. Every eye will see him, even those who pierced him. And on his account, all the tribes of the earth will wail. So it is to be. Amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Thanks be to God.
Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails, and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Indeed, this Sunday we would hope that we are moving from understanding to teaching. Last week was all about seeing, seeing and believing. Remember, it was that seesaw. What does it mean to see? And the various levels of seeing, coming into a knowledge and therefore coming into an understanding. And once we come into that understanding of belief, truly knowing, then we are compelled, like the apostles, to go and teach, to speak, to witness, to tell the story that we have heard, that we have seen, that we have felt in our own hearts, in our own lives, and to take it to our friends, our family, our neighbors, indeed to the nations. John 20, verse 27 says, "Do not doubt, but believe." And it's an interesting exercise of the word doubt. What is doubt? The true meaning from the Greek is the opposite of to believe. It's not a gradation. It's not something gradual. It's you either believe or you don't believe. Often when we think of the word doubt is that you're in a process of believing. You're not quite there. You think so, maybe, maybe not. I don't know, but I'm only doubting. I'm not saying I don't believe. You either believe or you don't believe. To not to believe, we use the word doubt, but the word is apistos. When the letter A is in front of another word, it means the opposite. It negates it. To believe, the Greek word is pistos. So you either have pistos or you're apistos. When we would trust that through reading the word, by hearing, and perhaps by seeing, we would truly come to believe. But we know from this scripture today, and even from last week's, that just because we see something, just because we hear something, or we read something, it doesn't mean that we've come to believe it. And especially with all of that fake news that's out there, what are we to believe? What are we to believe if we cannot believe the Holy Word of God that has been passed down from generation to generation and generation and proved through each generation for those who come into an understanding or at least a believing? Our gospel begins on the evening of that first day. We remember that on that first day, when the ladies had gone to the tomb and they realized that the great stone had been rolled away, and they looked in. Remember from last week? They didn't just look. They peered in, they bent over, they approached, and they looked in to see where Jesus was. The other disciples came and they looked from a distance. Some came in, some looked with wonder, some looked theorizing about what could have happened and what might have happened. But in all cases, the scripture today says they still had not come into a place of belief. Because Mary Magdalene, as we could read from Mark 16, and Mary Magdalene, she went and reported to those who had been with him while they were mourning and weeping. And when they heard that he was alive and had been seen by her, they refused to believe it. Mary had seen that the body was removed from the tomb. She had spoken to the angel. She had even spoken to the gardener, Jesus Christ. She had seen, she had felt. Even Jesus said, "Do not hold me. I still have to go to my Father." So she went with a sense of believing, a knowing. But when she spoke to the disciples, they would not believe her because they had not seen. They had not seen in a knowing sense or a fashion. But our text today says that Jesus was in the room with them. Even though the door was locked, Jesus Christ appeared among them. And I love that because sometimes when we lock our doors and we keep Jesus out of our lives, Jesus appears in miraculous ways to show us that he exists and he can be part of our lives today. And Jesus came and he stood among them and he shows them his hands and he shows them his side. And the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. And again, here's that word to see, eido. They saw knowing, not wondering, not pondering, not surmising. They saw and they knew and they believed that it was Jesus Christ. And what does Jesus say to them? And what is Jesus saying to each and every one of us?
As the Father has sent me, I send you. Again, you know, in this English translation, we use the same word, but thank goodness that this text was written in ancient Greek. And I invite you to do what I had to do. Take 5 years of it in university. Because when Jesus says, as the Father has sent me, it's the word apostello, apostle, to arrive with a mission. And then he says, and so I send you, but he uses a different word, pembo, which means that I am sending you so that you can transmit the message. I am sending you as presence. Imagine these words that he is saying to his disciples, that he has come as an apostle with a mission, is then sending them out as a gift to the people. He's saying that to each and every one of you today, that you are being sent out as apostles, but more than apostles, as gifts to your family, to your neighbors, and to the nations. And he gives them a mission, that they are to go and to forgive the sins of any, and if they do, they are forgiven. But if they don't, then they are retained. Not only are they retained by the person, but also by the person who should have given up those sins for them. And then there's Thomas. Thomas finds out that all the disciples have come into a true knowing because they have seen the hands, as we have seen the hands today. They have seen the side. And he says, somewhere here. I'll go by memory so I know it's here. He looks and he says, oh, unless I can see the marks in his hands, the marks on his side, unless I can put my hand in his side, I will not believe. That's how it's translated from the Greek. But the words, the verbs, are in the subjunctive. You see, the Greek has something like 6 or 7 different tenses, 12 different moods, all kinds of different things. That's why it takes you 5 years to learn it. But it's specific, because when he says, unless I can see his hands and put my fingers in the hole in his hands, I will not believe. What he's saying is, in the subjunctive, he has this desire and this hope to be fulfilled. In hope, in his faith, if it was to be fulfilled, he can move from doubt to belief. It's denoting a mood of verbs expressing what is imagined or wished for. So he says, unless I can imagine or have the possibility of seeing the marks of the nails in his hands, I will not be able to have that possibility or that wish to see and believe. And we take that as being just strictly unbelief, but he wants concrete proof. He wants what the others had. And shouldn't other people want what you have? That when you see the work of God happening in your own life, that when you can actually feel it as though you were putting your fingers in the hands of Jesus Christ and your hand in his side, to feel the Holy Spirit and the work of God, and when you express that to other people, they go through a sense of unbelief, of doubt, because they want what you have. They want to come to see and to feel and to know. That's why we encourage one another to encourage and invite others to come into the house of the Lord. Sure, they can stay at home and they can sit behind their TV screen and they can listen to us go on and sing and read the Word of God, but until you actually feel it in your body and your soul, you remain in a period of doubt, of disbelief rather than belief. This past week, there have been times where it's as though Jesus Christ was standing in front of me and said, here, I am with you. Put your fingers into the holes in my hands and realize that I am with you today. On Friday, Joyce and I were honored to be here. I sit in my usual place and Joyce is sitting here. And our eyes continually met because we continually realized that Jesus Christ was in charge of this funeral. It was a funeral for Madeleine Lalonde. Some of you may know her. Her
married name was Stevenson. Her husband was here, Edward. And when Joyce and I were walking a couple days ahead of time, she said to me, Brian, do you know about Madeline? Have you had a chance to speak with the family? And I said, no, it's been one of those things where the daughter's from Florida. So what are you going to say? And I said, well, I can only preach from the scriptures. I can only preach from what I can read and what I can see. And the scriptures were the Beatitudes, where those who are in mourning will be comforted. Those who are thirsty will receive drink. Those who go through tough times will be comforted. And I said, as a mother, as a grandmother, she must have been exactly that. And on Friday, when we began to meet with the family, and I was speaking to the grandson, and I said, could you tell me a little bit about your mom, your grandma? Oh, she was wonderful. If we ever had trouble, we would go and see her. If we were crying, if we were upset, she would help us through that. She would make us lunches and make us suppers, and she had that word of knowledge of all times. And Joyce and I looked at each other and we said, that's the word of God. And so at this point where we hadn't seen these people and yet they were excited to be back in their church of St. Barnabas, where they had been baptized, where they had been married, where they had brought their children to be baptized, and now they were gathering around their mother for that final sacrament, that final atoning love of God as they are whisked up into heaven. And we see this repeatedly by being here and present in the church. And we look forward to the day when we'll be able to all take off our masks, we'll be able to gather together and see the miracles that are happening here. That I can sit around with our board of directors, our wardens, our management unit. And after looking at the financials of this past few months and these past couple of years where we've seen such a transition of such activity, that they say, and one particular person who knows what's going on in the other churches, and they said, probably we are the best run, most efficient church in Montreal, if not across Canada at this point. But yet there are some people who still don't believe it because they have not seen it, because they are not here. They don't receive the emails from the ladies group who have rented space, giving us four times what we used to collect for that space. And now they are renting Memorial Hall for extra revenue. And it's not about the revenue, but imagine they are having an annual general meeting for the 50 women's groups that call together to work one with the other in our Memorial Hall. That they'll be having a conference in Memorial Hall as well. That people from all over the South Shore will come together to gather in the building of St. Barnabas to nurture one another. But yesterday afternoon, there was a Brazilian wedding in here. And if any of you saw it on Facebook, the beautiful picture of the aisle decorated. The Brazilians are worshiping this morning, and yesterday they were in here worshiping and celebrating the marriage of two of their congregants. Coming together. And these are these opportunities where we can not only see, we can not only hear, but we can feel the word of God in our hearts, and we go from doubting to believing. In Revelation it says that I've made us to be a kingdom, priests serving to God and Father. To make us is to bring us along, forming pieces and elements together before we are sent. And all of these things that happen during the week are those elements and pieces that form us together so that we can go as a kingdom. The Greek word is basileus, which means king. In other words, son of the emperor, son of the Messiah, son of God, which is Jesus Christ. And as priests, it's a metaphor for Christians who have been purified by the blood, the sacrament of Christ that we will partake of today. I can see some of you looking at your watches, so I'm going to close this up here. But there's so much in our text. There's so much, if we really truly read it and understand it and feel it and see it and realize what it is we are called to do. We are not called just to be spectators to come and listen and hum a few bars. We are come to allow the Word of God to become part of our lives. And then we go as witnesses to go out and to spread the gospel, to enhance other people,
so that they too will come to know the Word of God in their lives today and for eternal life.
Let us stand together as we affirm our faith, reciting the Nicene Creed. Indeed, let us confess our faith as we say, we believe in one God, Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. For him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended to heaven and seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again with glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Dear friends in Christ, God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy. He welcomes sinners and invites them to his table. Let us now confess our sins, confident in God's forgiveness. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you
forgiveness, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please bow our hearts in prayer.
We begin our prayers of the people with these words: do not doubt, but believe. We pray for the church, that we may be transformed through our encounters with the living Christ and be instruments of healing and forgiveness for those who are hurting. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for all believers, that we may be instruments through whom others encounter Christ and give witness to Christ's presence by our words and deeds. Lord, in your mercy,
amen.
We pray for the grace to forgive, that the Spirit of God will help us to forgive as God has forgiven us, and give us the strength to be instruments of forgiveness in our families and communities. Lord, in your mercy,
amen.
We pray for all who struggle with doubts and fear, that Christ may calm their fears, help someone to accompany them, and touch their hearts with peace. Lord, in your mercy,
amen.
We pray for all who are suffering, that God will heal the sick, comfort the grieving. And this morning we remember the family of Liz Anion and Andrew Lawson in Liz's passing this week. The presence with the family at this time. We ask for you to guide refugees to safety and open resources to those who lack food and medicine. Lord, in your mercy. And we pray for peace in all the troubled areas of the world, particularly in Ukraine, that Christ's victory over death may bring an end to war, genocide, and inhuman treatment of people, and help us to work together to end disease and malnutrition. Lord, in your mercy. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
Thank you.
blessings flow. Praise God, all creatures, high and low. Give thanks to God in love made known, Creator, Word, and Spirit one. God of grace, you have freed us from our sins and made us a kingdom in your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Accept all we offer you this day and strengthen us in the new life you have given us through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Blessed are you, gracious God, creator of heaven and earth. We give you thanks and praise through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who on this first day of the week overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection, opened to us the way of everlasting life. In our unending joy, we echo on earth the song of the angels in heaven as we raise our voices to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You may be seated. We give thanks to you, Lord our God, for the goodness and love you have made known to us in creation, in calling Israel to be your people, and your word spoken through the prophets, and above all, in the Word made flesh, Jesus your Son. For in these last days, you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him, you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him, you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, and out of death into life. On the night that Jesus was handed over to suffering and death, a death he freely accepted, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And after supper, Jesus took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, Father, according to his command, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory, and we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament for the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we, made acceptable in him, may be sanctified by the Holy Spirit. And in the fullness of time, reconcile all things in Christ and make them new, and bring us to that city of light where you dwell with all your sons and daughters, through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Amen. And now, rejoicing in the presence of God, let us pray as Jesus taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Lord, we died with you on the cross.
Now we are raised to new life.
We were buried in your tomb.
Now we are in your resurrection.
Live in us that we may live in you.
the gifts of God, for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Father, we have seen with our eyes and touched with our hands the bread of life. Strengthen our faith that we may grow in love for you and for each other. Through Jesus Christ, the risen Lord. Amen. Glory to God. whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to God from generation to generation, in the church and in Christ Jesus, forever and ever. Amen. God, Creator, with the Holy Spirit, may we emulate Jesus in sharing the bread of life, teaching his word so others may also come to believe. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among us and remain with us always. Amen. And now our closing hymn, Yours Be the Glory.
Thank you.